today. Dr. Margaret Batten, she goes by Peggy. Dr. Batten is a distinguished professor of philosophy and adjunct professor of internal medicine at the University of Utah. She has an MFA in fiction writing,
which you're used to now.
Not the whole thing. And a PhD in philosophy. And she's a recipient of the University of Utah's Distinguished Research Award. She has authored, co-authored, edited, or co-edited some 20 books on a wide variety of subjects. She's been engaged in research on active euthanasia and assisted suicide in the Netherlands. In 2000, she received the Rosenblatt Prize, the University of Utah's most prestigious award. Her body of work on bioethics is extensive and well-known, and she's been named one of the mothers of bioethics. She recently collaborated with two other brilliant women, playwright Julie Jensen and actor Anne Colmore-Decker, on a play titled Winter, dealing with end-of-life issues. And it premiered this year at Sully Acting Company. James and I saw it. It was really great. I really enjoyed it. And as you've already seen from her video clip, she has a keen personal and professional insight on these end-of-life issues. And we're very excited and privileged to have her here today. So please welcome Dr. Thorne.
Thanks. It's a little hard to... interesting, maybe you might even say dislocating, to go from the blues that has been in Wiley Play to begin with. I thought that was a fine setup for this sort of sober topic, death and dying. But then we see the film when you come back and you're doing this upbeat stuff. So we need to calm down again a little bit and think more seriously about these issues. So instead of giving a formal talk with lots more slides, I thought we might engage in a little discussion both of issues that this film raises and anything else. But everybody here have a pencil or something to write with? No?
We have lots of crayons here.
Yeah, crayons. I thought I'd have this nice little book from the administration here, and I have a serious question to ask you. And this is, it's challenging to answer this question if you haven't thought about it or if you don't want to think about it. But just pass this around. Let's divide it up a little bit. I'm told we can use the whole thing.
Take a sheet.
And on the sheet, if you will, and don't put your name on it, and this is not going to be attributed to you. Say, because we're talking about death and dying, right? And as far as deaths go, every one of us will get one. This is not news to anybody. But the question is, how, if you had your druthers, would you like your own death to go? We all have some ideas or some worries or concerns or fears or more pleasant expectations about how we think it will happen. But how you'd like it to happen is a different question. So just a fragment of a sentence, the tiniest little description about how you'd like it to go. I've been providing you coffee this morning. This is great. I'm in the club. How would you like it to go? That isn't to say that it will go that way, but if you had your brothers, what would suit you as the person you are more than any of the other possibilities? I sometimes like to call this the least worst death. This isn't to suggest that death is a great thing and we should all be delighted by it and could have a wave and that kind of stuff, but what would be the least bad of all the things you can think of? When you get done, fold this paper up in half or in quarters, and then mail it around so that somebody else has it. And then don't put your name on it. Mail it around so that somebody else has it and it's completely anonymous. So, and before we make any use of it, and before you look at it, the one you get, and if you haven't finished yet, wait and finish. Let's see if there are any things in this video that you'd like to talk about first before we do this little exercise. Anybody have any questions about it? I should add that this was made in 2014. Since then, two more states have been added to the U.S. count of states that have legal aid in dying. That's California, and just in the past election, Colorado, and the entire country of Canada. So, are you from Canada?
No. No, but I had the unique pleasure of watching my mom. We had to watch my mom suffer through an autoimmune disease that pretty much robbed her of her ability to move or talk or do anything besides laying in bed, sort of mom, in a nursing home or a fast food home. And it was a really slow and terrible process and thing to watch. So
I hope you can all hear this because this is.
So it's important to me that we legalize it and make it a viable option for people who are suffering.
Even this issue of legalization aside, what I heard was, of the ways that I would want my own death to go if I had my druthers, this would be way, way down the list. This shouldn't happen. Unless that Utah also as a matter of statute, provides a list of who will be the decision maker if you don't choose somebody else. So it's your spouse first, then your adult children, is that right?
Yeah, you can have a second, whoever you'd like as your second agent.
But there's a list if you don't choose anybody.
Oh, yes, the default, the statutory default.
Yeah, so that's worth knowing about. It's not that there won't be anybody.
But you got to go to court first to get that default in place. You have to go to court and hire two attorneys to double bill you, $500 to $700 an hour. So do it ahead of time.
Does anybody else have any questions about the film at all? Yeah.
Were there any legal ramifications to your husband's decision? He didn't just talk somebody into doing that, and he did everybody would be afraid.
Well, we just saw this film, right? And when Ted Ned approached me, there was a scout in the audience somewhere, to make a long matter short, they had two advanced people who interview you before they decide whether they want to work with you. There's a doctor. The doctor had some questions. There's a lawyer. And the first question out of the lawyer's mouth was his death illegal? That was the question. This is someone fairly recently bereaved, and they think, well, the answer is, it was legal, and it's legal because everywhere in this country, it is legal for a patient to refuse any treatment that they don't want, whether or not they've already accepted it to begin with. That's why another situation is so interesting. And as I said, by that time, we had five different things that were keeping them alive. So a cardiac pacer, respiratory pacer, external oxygen feeding tube, and a ventilator. And he had a little right. And he knew this because we've been talking about this kind of stuff for years. He knew that he had the legal right to have any or all of them discontinued, and that's what he did. So he went to see his doctor, his spinal cord physician, because he's paralyzed from the neck down. And the spinal cord doc spent, in the era of 15-minute clinic visits, spent almost 3 hours with him, right, to make sure that this was his genuine choice. And although I was there, our adult kids were there, his respiratory therapists were there, because he had to have them around all the time. The doctor also interviewed Brooke privately, with nobody else in the room, as well as with all of us. And when he was satisfied that this was this man's genuine choice, and he'd written a letter a year in advance in which he had said, this is what I'll be requesting, and had everybody in the family sign it, all of his caretakers sign it, even had his physician sign it, so that there was no question about his intention. So then the doctor referred him to hospice. And the hospice physician then actually was the one who came and presided over the discontinuation of the ventilator. Hospice physician and a hospice nurse and two respiratory therapists. But that was completely legal. There was never any question about that. But of course you have to have a ventilator or a feeding tube or, diaphragm pacer or that kind of stuff, and most of us won't have those things, whether we have cancer or some kind of dementia or whatever, various kinds of organ failure. The opportunity, if you can call it that, that being dependent on some sort of life support provides isn't there for anything else? Yeah.
My mother had ALS, and she eventually decided to refuse care and died fairly soon after that. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how common it is for people to refuse care versus how common it is for them to choose physician-assisted death.
Well, it's hard to answer that question because physician-assisted dying, that is the provider, under the statutes that are now the case in six states in this country, what the physician can only do is provide a prescription for a lethal drug. It's usually a barbiturate. And some instruction, like take the medication out of the capsules and mix it, it's very bitter, you mix it with something, you have to swallow it very rapidly, you take an antiemetic beforehand. That's all the physician can do. He or she cannot administer it, can't urge it. There's a bill in the in committee in the legislature in this state, like some 20 other states. In this state, it identifies all the things that must be the case to be a resident, to be adult, to be competent. You have to have a terminal illness that's defined as expected to die within 6 months. You have to make two requests 15 days apart, plus a written request. There have to be evaluations by two independent physicians. If there's any question about whether depression or other mental illness is clouding your judgment, then you're referred for a psychological or a psychiatric consult. And a few other things I think I'm forgetting, but the point was, what about how many people that have their deaths occur by refusing treatment versus direct assisted dying? Well, we can't answer the direct assisted dying very carefully because in most of the country it's underground. It's not that it doesn't occur, but it's underground. In the states where it is legal, so that's Oregon, Washington, Vermont, Montana has no statute, but it's a Supreme Court decision. California and now Colorado. We have California and Colorado too recent for to have any data, but we have 20 years worth of data for Oregon. There, the frequency of direct physician-assisted dying, that is the writing of a prescription under the law, is of people who die in a given year, that is the total annual mortality. You want to guess what proportion? You must have known it's actually 0.3%. It's a tiny fraction, but it's viewed as an option by many. And people say this is a comfort to know that this is there. And of the people in recent years who actually get prescriptions, so they've gone through all the hoops, right, they get a legal prescription for lethal substance, only about two-thirds of them actually take it. Sometimes they happen to die more rapidly or something else happens. Sometimes they say, they report it as saying, well, it's an amazing comfort to have this, but I never reached the point where so the rest of your question is how many people die by having treatment or some of the things discontinued. There's lots of data about that. I'm not sure I can quote you exact figures in this country. In the Netherlands, I think about something else. Terminal sedation is now, terminal sedation, that is the control of pain and symptoms, other symptoms, by sedating a person into unconsciousness. Is someone who's working in palliative care? Right. So you could say what terminal sedation is, or extended palliative sedation.
So they would give patients medications to prevent them from experiencing the negative effects of the end of life. So if they're having pain, they give pain medications. If they're having anxiety, they give them stimulants. And they can bring it, it's a level of consciousness can be either, you can be alert, but not completely feeling everything. Or they can actually bring you to a level of unconsciousness. Like she said, you're not aware of what's going on.
This practice has a lot of various names: terminal sedation, extended palliative sedation, deep high sedation, and so on. And of course, the issue about it is whether it reduces consciousness below the point some of you want. So would you want your approach to death be to be alert and awake? Would you want it to be sedated? Which do you think would have a kind of impact on your family if you were concerned with that? So these are all issues that someone, that an understanding physician, and hospice, of course, is particularly skilled at this, as one approaches death, tries to sort out with people. What counts as least worst for you, right? Yeah.
So we're talking about a lot of the ethics and the political side of this. What about the experience for those who are left alive afterwards and maybe what they desire as far as their own interest in that experience and their saying as well?
Like family members and close friends, yeah. So not the one who is terminally ill or who has died. Family has no legal claim in any circumstance that I'm aware of over how the person dies, provided the person themselves is still competent. Now, once they are no longer competent, that is deeply sedated or have an illness that affects mental function, then it's the family members who are now decision makers in the order we just identified, first spouse, unless they've designated someone else. Then you can designate anybody you want to. Right? It could be a friend, it could be some other relative. You could issue an advance directive that says, well, I'll have my family in the following, statutorily stipulated order, except not for so-and-so, right? The idea is to try to give the person themselves, the patient, as wide a range of choice as they might want about how the circumstances of their dying goes. And in particular, the trade-offs between alertness and freedom from pain. Yeah.
So we've primarily been discussing this as a philosophical, ethical, or emotional issue. What about practicality? The economics of sustaining life, the cost of Medicaid, the cost of life care, how will that influence this hard set emotional culture? Will that change it?
I believe you might be stepping on the third rail in this issue.
Right.
Nobody wants to talk about this. There is data about how much of, no politician, let's put it that way, wants to talk about this. There's a different, economists are perfectly willing to talk about it, but it's viewed as treacherous for politicians, a sort of deathbed kind of thing. There is data about how much of the annual general medical budget is spent on, I think this is Medicare data, sorry, is spent during the last half year or months of life. And that data is pretty complex. It's a large proportion, but it also, after all, includes people who died even after heroic attempts to preserve them, heroic and plausible attempts to preserve them. So actually, the older you are, the more the costs go down. It's different by, oh, I see a sign that says 5 minutes, it's flashing in the back.
So let's just
sidestep this question. The question about bereavement is very real. What about the impact on the family? There's a huge literature and it goes like this. There's, there's denial, bargaining, anger or something. In my own experience, after Book Dad, these stages don't make any sense to me. I'm going to invent my own, right, that describe my experience. And they all happen to start with S. There are four of them, and somebody added a fifth one on the front for an unexpected death, which would be first shock. But, of course, in my case, the shock started perfect almost 5 years, so the shock was a long time before. But then came sorrow, howling, even sometimes just that. Then seclusion. So the natural withdrawal. You do what you have to do, but you don't initiate anything. It doesn't feel like depression, it feels different. Then solitude. The solitude is a much more normal condition of life. It doesn't have that sort of pathological or abnormal thing. And then, on good days, a touch of serenity, in which you say, no, we had this wonderful life. Here's a man who, even despite this awful accident, loved his life. As he said, he was so glad he'd been rescued. Then was able to make his own choice when things got worse. And so, I mean, digest all that, and you say, well, that's way better than other things that could have happened. Now, in 5 minutes, which is now 4.5 minutes, right? You have these little pieces of paper. So if you mail it around so it's not your piece of paper, and read what's on it. Because the question was, how would you like your death to go? Why don't I start across the back row down here? Yeah. We know the back row is very special here because not only does he get to put away the chairs. Instantaneously, without awareness, without any antecedent.
Wham, bam, gone.
Wham, bam, gone. Let's go, keep going across the back row.
This says, with as little pain as possible to my loved ones.
Ah, thinking about other people than oneself. Next one. Remember, these are not the authors of these.
Expected, surrounded by family, painless, and peaceful.
Uh-huh. Let's go across this next row, yeah?
Quickly, painlessly, with foreknowledge.
But with foreknowledge?
Foreknowledge, yeah.
I know it's going to happen, but I want it to be quick and painless, right? What's yours?
Peacefully in my sleep, next to love my life on a mountain.
Do you all hear that? Peacefully, something, and on a mountain after a day of hiking. With my loved one, right? Yeah. Dying peacefully at home, surrounded by family. And notice how different this one is, wherever it came from the one that you read, well, that also came from somewhere else. This one was, I don't want to know anything about it. It just happened. I don't want to even experience it. No pain, no nothing. Right? Just out. And this one has something that's quite different. It assumes that I'll be awake, I'll be alert, I'll be aware of my family. It has the flavor of being at home. I don't think it said that. Anybody have one that says, I want to die at home? Yours? Yeah.
It says, quick but not too soon at home.
Sorry?
Quick but not too soon at home.
Quick but not too soon, I hope. This is pretty young crowd, so yeah. Anybody else have one that's different? Yeah?
Just at home, peacefully with loved ones.
At home, between loved ones.
Yeah, peacefully with loved ones.
Yeah. Anybody else have one that needs to read? Yours is very long.
I want to die surrounded by loved ones, if possible, out in nature. I want a natural burial.
Oh, that's pretty elaborate, but it's also quite specific. And the difference between the one in which I don't want to know anything about it and the one in which all the details are spelled out is actually, I think, a difference that describes different ways we approach dying. So I sometimes ask strangers about how they'd like to die, and about half of them give answers like that. I'd just like to go to sleep and never wake up. networking events was much more like this one. I remember a woman I met somewhere who said, "Well, I'd like to be at the beach, facing west towards the sunset." So you know, she was the West Coast beach, right? "I'd like to have so and so of my family, all except that one." And she told me all about the music she wanted to have be played. Now, the thing about that takes a vast amount of organization, right? If it's going to be hiking or in the woods somewhere, and that requires a degree of family or friends or whoever's part of one's world, cooperation. So when we think about how we want to die, which was the whole exercise here, we won't all give the same answers and we don't all want the same things, but it's important to think. I think I put it this way. This is relevant to the living world's part, and I'll do it in 1 minute. That when we make our choices about death and dying now, what we tend to do is say what we don't want. I don't want to be on a respirator. I don't want pressors. I don't want to be in the hospital. I don't want whatever else they say that they don't want. We say what we don't want, but we don't generally think about what we do want. So flip it around. So this question that you just got asked is a flip around of the way you normally think about death and dying. This asks you what you do want. And some people would want it this way, some people would want it that way. And now the next step, for which we are out of time, is to figure out how to make it most likely that that's the way it will actually occur. That's the role of one's own choices and what leads up to that in, yeah, thank you.